Heavenly Father, we do just again, we thank you for this place, Lord. We thank you for the provisions, for
those that are willing to just take away from their Saturday to help this be a success, Lord. And we pray for those that you've drawn up here to work on them, and that you would, that you'd work on them as well as work on all of us, Lord. That even if there's guys that, you know, missed the last session because they were cooking hamburgers, that you would speak to them where they're at, Lord, and that they'd be ministered to, and it wouldn't just be a duty, but it would be that relationship, Lord. And that you would just help us to build each other up, Lord. Prepare us for the words that you've given, the message that you've given to Ernest, and be in this worship, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You get the idea. Christ is my reward, and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back, I've been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Christ my all in all. Joy of my salvation. And this hope will never fail. Heaven is all. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Cross the cross before. Behind me, no turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me, no turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I need. Worthy of every song we could ever sing.
worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you.
Holy. Worthy.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Jesus.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say.
Worthy.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Besides you, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and fill. in your love to those around me. I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures of faith are never enough. You came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Better than you, there's nothing. Better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Turn around.
You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
God.
My life is built on your faithfulness. My hope is held in your promises. I take each step with your confidence, 'cause I am yours. I am yours.
You never fail.
You never fail. You never will. I'll trust your name. The greater thing you brought me back from brokenness. You took my shame and you buried it. For what you've done, I won't forget. You never fail. You greater things you will come through, you always do. I'll trust your name for greater things. You never fail, you never will. I'll trust your name for greater things. You will come through, you always do. I'll trust your name for greater things. I will not fear, for you are with me. I'll see this fight from the victory. No power of hell stand against me. So I've seen this fight from the victory. I will not fear, for you are with me. I'll see this fight from the victory. No power of hell can stand against me. I've seen this fight from the victory.
You never fail.
You never fail. You never fail. I'll trust your name for greater things. You will come through. You
Father, we do just trust you, Lord. We pray that you would just open our hearts. Oh, we thank you. Thank you for this just ability, Lord, to praise your name, to study your word, and to know you. Help us to know you deeper. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Hi, I'm Ernest Updike. I know Thomason. Have you ever called... anybody ever call him Thomason?
No, you're the only one. Not anymore.
Or we used to call him El Capitan.
My Spanish teacher called me Tomas.
Tomas, or El
we
Capitan.
Just Tomas.
Well, God's doing a beautiful work in your guys' lives in Calvary Meridian and Calvary Garden Valley. just in talking to some of you guys, I mean, honestly, this is so appropriate for our times right now. More than ever in my lifetime, we need warriors for the Lord. So I was so encouraged when Tommy's son told me about your topic. I said, okay, that's awesome. That's going to be a great time. So, and then they, you know, him and Pastor Troy got to split it up. And they gave me the best part. I get to do the power tools. You guys know power tools? We love power tools. I used to drive a propane truck here, and during the off season, we'd paint propane tanks. And to prep a tank, well, especially one of those big ones, by hand, it's like, this is really. So he finally got me a grinder, and it was like, oh, power tools, man. I love power tools. So we're going to be talking about God's power tools today, okay? So let's open in our Bibles to Ephesians 6. I'm actually going to pick up in verse 14. Tom said, didn't you get my memo? I said, you know, Tom, my wife and I have a very strange and wonderful relationship. She cooks, I eat. She makes me lists, and I lose them. So I said, oh, I'm going to start with having girded your waist with truth. Okay, so we're going to. So let's read through it. Ephesians 6:14. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in the power of your Holy Spirit. And I thank you that we have this opportunity as this new year is unfolding, 2021, to really be change agents for you, Lord, for your kingdom and for your glory. I know there's a lot of stuff going on, a lot of moving parts in everybody's lives, but today, Lord, this afternoon, we're gathered here to honor you and to glorify you and to ask for more of you in our lives. And that is your will for our lives too. So I thank you, Lord, that that is what you're willing to do for us. Our part is to ask, and we ask, Lord. We praise you now, we give you all the glory. In your name, Lord Jesus, amen. All right, so before we get into the power tools, I want to talk about our attitude. Because, you know, sometimes, especially if we're talking about power tools, we can get caught up into the tools, and we forget what it's all about, okay? Pastor Troy and Tom did a super job kind of getting us moved in that direction. But I want to talk a little bit about that attitude. I've been with Calvary Chapel for a lot of years, and I remember Greg Laurie sharing at a conference once. He's the pastor of Harvest Ministries, and some of you are aware of him. They've just had a tremendous blooming during this pandemic. But when he first took over his church at Harvest, it was 500 people, and he took it down to 5. Okay? He was a young guy and pretty discouraged. Then he went to Chuck Smith, and he said, Chuck, how do I succeed in God? And, you know, honestly, that's the topic of our conference, how to win the spiritual war. And as he was recounting the story to us at a pastor's conference, he said, you know, Chuck looked at him, you know, because Greg's just a young kid. He's like 18, 19 years old. And in that great baritone voice of Chuck, he said, to win in Christ, he says, it's very simple. Just remember that God is everything and you're nothing. Wow. Okay.
So how does that apply to us today? Because we're going to be getting into the power tools. Well, it's not about us. And the power of God he's going to give us is for his glory and for his use. But there's some challenges we have to overcome, some obstacles. I like James when he was sharing about, you know, trying to be transparent, trying to be open. He's going to be following up here shortly with some awesome questions in the back of your pamphlet to help you open up to one another. Because we honestly, me included, everybody, oftentimes live a lie. There's a song called Truth Be Told. And Matthew West, he says there's basically two lies. That you're supposed to have it all together, and then when they ask you how you're doing, you just smile and you say that you've never been better. Okay? Wow. I've done that. The second lie is everyone's life is perfect except yours, so keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. But the truth be told, that the truth is rarely told. So before we get into this awesome section on God's power tools for us, it's important that we understand that this spiritual armor is not individual. You know, as Paul's writing this, obviously there's going to be some references back to Isaiah 59 and some other places, but he's chained to a Roman Praetorian guard, Caesar's own personal guard, 24/7. So he's got a lot of time to check out armor. And that's why I wanted to start with the first one, girding your waist with truth. Because the truth be told, as the truth is not often told. And this is the most critical component in your armor. But as he was chained to these ongoing shifts of soldiers that he got to lead many of them to the Lord, he started realizing, okay, there's something's going on here. For you and I, you know, we don't have, it's an allusion here to a belt, but they would have a cloth or a tunic, like a big square cloth, and a hole for the head and holes for the arms, and that's what they wore in just regular time. But when the time came for the battle, you know, the bugle sounded or the drum, and hey, you had this special belt that you would pull up your tunic, and that would get you ready for battle. You get your mind, your attitude, I'm ready to go to war. And it's about truth. You know, Jesus, the same word for truth is used by Jesus when he described that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man can come to the Father except through him. He also went on to tell us that Satan is the father of all lies. So this is an essential component in our battle, this truth. And for you and I to address that truth, we have to understand that we need help, which is kind of like anti-guy. I don't need help. I can do it. Famous last words. We honestly need help. When Jesus said, you know, this new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, excuse me? Can you do that? Man, I fail miserably at all that stuff. So you have to understand that's why God gives us this fellowship of brothers, family, sisters in Christ. And for you and I to be warriors of God, we need to have an openness and a transparency. That these questions afterwards are designed to try to help you move forward in this process. But this first attitude is that you need help. All of us. I had a son who got blessed to go to West Point from this little town of Garden Valley. And there was a very famous author who couldn't figure out why West Point was so weird. He said, because, you know, they have the top of the nation. The year before he was picked, they were picked the top school in the country. So they had people like brainiacs. He'd say, Dad, there's people who've maxed SATs, ACTs, it's crazy. Star athletes, you name it. Well, with this author, it wasn't Stephen Covey, and I couldn't find his article, But he couldn't figure out what was wrong with West Point, because when you have such an extreme talent of people, there should be a lot of competitiveness and one-upmanship and stab you in the back. And there wasn't at all. He was there 2 semesters, and he couldn't find it. So what he found out was their attitude, which I'm going to encourage for you and I to have, is that the school so overwhelmed you, I mean, with work, unbelievable, physical, mental, emotional, there was no way you could succeed. And it changed those highly competitive, highly structured, highly, I'm not. My son takes after his mom. It changed them where they realized, we're not going to make it. We're not going to cut it. So if we're not going to cut it, let's have fun together. And it developed a camaraderie. You guys know what camaraderie means, right? That's what I believe the Holy Spirit wants to work in our lives, a camaraderie. That this armor that we're going to look at, it's for a group. What made the Romans so successful wasn't individual. And yet we take it individually. It's as a group. So this is a group armor. You know, he got many, many soldiers chained to him. So he got to see this. So the first one he says is truth. This is so critical. And this is absolute truth. I pulled up a definition of it, just both where Jesus said he's the way, the truth, and the life. It's candor, sincerity, truthfulness. It's rooted in the objective and the reality of the truth of God's word. In this case, it refers to the subjective application of openness and honesty with all things, with God and with people. And that's what you and I have to put on first, is truth. Let the truth be known. Let God be true and every man a liar. So, you know, and that's really hard for us guys, for me. you know, but nothing happens until that starts. So I'm going to encourage you when we get together here shortly to, you know, just be open. Hey, we love you. We got your back. God's got your back. He brought you here for a purpose. If you don't know God, now's the day. Today is the day of salvation. For others who are struggling in areas, he's going to address them as we go through this armor. But hey, just understand God's got your back. And he wants you to have this belt of truth that everything is going to connect to. So it has to start here. I think I'm preaching to the choir, because you guys are probably living that way in your lives. But I find oftentimes in the world, or the pressures, or the expediency is to shade the truth, to not be forthcoming. And he says, no, it has to start there. It has to start with the truthfulness that God would give to us. We have to have an attitude of truth. Warren Wiersbe, in his book, Spiritual Warfare, he says that's so critical. This whole section, he says, he calls it what to wear to war, okay? Because we are in a war. Tom and Pastor Troy showed it. We're in a war. And Satan's out to destroy you. And he doesn't take prisoners. When my sons used to wrestle, my sons are really, they're really friendly. You got to get out of that. That person you're going to be fighting on the map doesn't want to be your friend, because they're going to shake. And that's just their nature. They want to rip your head off. They want to hurt you and gleefully stomp on you. And they really had a hard time until they finally got into the battle. So that's Satan. Satan wants to tackle you, take you down, as Troy was putting out. And we have this opportunity. We have many people in the scriptures to give us examples. You know, David messed up a lot. And when he sinned with Bathsheba, had her husband Uriah killed. And it wasn't for a year later, you know, he married Bathsheba and they lost that one child. And it wasn't for a year that he just could never come to the truth. And then finally, Psalm 51, really, as Nathan popped his bubble. And you know, some of us maybe today need our bubbles popped. I've had my bubble pop many times. It's okay. God loves you, and your brothers love you, and they'll forgive you. But the fruit of that repentance, I love, it's in Psalm 139, where David, as he's reflecting on that, the fruit of getting right with God, of moving forward in life, this having this truth. He says, search me, O God. And I'm going to read this verse 23 and 24 of Psalm 139, because I'm going to encourage you to start your day with these verses. Start your day putting on the armor of God. We're going to see that we all have this armor through Christ, but we have to be the ones who put it on. And it's just as the Roman soldiers, hey, I'm just chilling, I'm relaxing, that's okay, but there's a battle right now for your soul and for your family and for your future. So search me, O God, and know my heart, try me, and know my anxieties, and see if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. So I hate to belabor the point, but this is the starting point before we can jump into the power tools. Because, yeah, amen for that. Because that's, without this, nothing else goes. And I've broke these up into three parts. We're going to call the first three basic training. Then the next are going to be special op training. Both offensive and defensive. Okay, so basic training, because he's going to use certain words. He says you're having girded, you've put this around. Notice he says your waist. Some of your translations, your loins, the most vulnerable, the most important part of your life. Your loins are going to be ready for battle, and he says this is that belt of truth. You have to come clean. I have several friends now who've fallen for different sins. And one thing is common to all of them, they didn't have accountability. They didn't have anybody to be truthful and honest to. And it really beats me up sometimes, because I could have. You know, if I'd been obviously listening to the Holy Spirit or close, you know, because I was close to these guys. But I was too busy, too focused, too much, and I forgot this idea that we're comrades in arms. I would give anything to go back to some of these guys and serve them by washing their feet and helping them, to encourage them to come true with the struggles that they had. So this is so huge, because then following that, because you know, Eve was deceived, and by the enemy of all lies. Don't be deceived when lack of truth attacks you. And it could be through social media, it could be through it's all around us. So don't fall for that. The opposite of truth is deception. So don't come to that area where you're a statistic for the kingdom of God. But then he says, now we want to put on a breastplate of righteousness. And this was actually hooked onto this belt. The next attack of the enemy, if he can't trip you up on lying, he's going to try to condemn you. Tell you you're worthless, tell you you're no good, tell you you're a failure. Kind of like Job's wife when she told him, go curse God and die. You know, I always find it interesting that later when God restored him everything that he'd lost, that included children, and it was with that wife. So he had a lot more children with her too, so that was kind of cool. We serve a redeeming God. But this breastplate, he says, of righteousness, again, it protects my vital organs, and it's the one that God is going to use in my life to keep me safe from the enemy's attack. Righteousness, there's two aspects of righteousness. We have the imputed righteousness by faith in Christ when we come to him and trust him for our lives, and we're born again, we're saved. But then there's the imparted righteousness. And both of those are caught up in this idea of a breastplate of righteousness. That not only am I now right with God, but because I'm right with God, I can be right with people. I can be a person of integrity. I can be a person of honesty. I can live up to my name, Ernest? I've never been Ernest in my life until I got saved. It's kind of funny. So, you know, you can be who God has called you to be by his righteousness, by his washing of the water of the word. And I had written this down because I thought this was so good. Put it simply, to be right is to put into practice what you know is right. Wow, okay. Yeah, so if I am staying in God's word, I'm in fellowship, I'm coming before the Lord in prayer, he's going to convict you. Righteousness is just doing what's right. And that'll protect me from the enemy's condemnation, because God will never condemn me. He poured out all his anger, all his rage that I deserve on his son on the cross. And I've been set free by that, by the blood of the Lamb. So he's going to transform you, and he's going to transform me. But the purpose from God, he says, is this righteousness, this right standing with God that allows me to take on the world. It is, in a sense, it's a power tool because I can't do it. Can you be right? I'm like Ernest Strong, okay? God can make me right. God can make me. I'm always surprised when people come up and say, God, you know, God's used you for this. God's, and you go, wow, God, well, that's God. That's all God. That's not me. Because I know me, but I know God. And if that you're experiencing that righteousness from God, it comes from knowing him and following after him and experiencing that, what he later will call the John, the joy of your salvation. One of the most transforming times in my life in this aspect of righteousness was when I was going through the Bible with Chuck on by tape, and we were in John 13, where Peter, full of himself, kind of like us sometimes, was saying, hey, Lord, they're all going to deny you. I'm not. And at the end of John 13, Jesus says, Peter, will you lay down your life for me also? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow until you have denied me three times. He knew what was going to happen. Okay. Unfortunately, there's a chapter break. And when Chuck was taking us through that, he said, "In this, because Jesus kept talking. You know, you're going to mess up. You're going to fall. You're going to fail. You're going to let your brother down, your sister down, your wife down. You're going to, there's way too much out there for you to do it by your own self. You're going to need help." So in John 14, verse 1, Jesus said, he keeps talking. Don't let your heart be troubled. So this is going back to the righteousness of Christ. Don't let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's houses are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Chuck was sharing there. He says, you know, you'll never disappoint God. I don't know about you guys. I grew up in a religion that preached guilt. And because they were into works, and I was not anywhere. You know, like I said, my wife's the list maker. I'm the list loser. How are you doing on your list, honey? You know, what list? You know, where's that list, Tom? So, you know, I it was horrible. That set me free. If Jesus was not disappointed with Peter, who was going to deny, he said, hey, I know you're going to deny tonight before the rooster crows. You're going to deny me tonight. Wow. That changed my life. Because it set me free from all my self-imposed bondage. It gave me that breastplate of righteousness. I'm right with God through faith in Christ. No matter, you know, nothing hits me. It's going to bounce off because I'm covered by the blood of the Lamb. As 1 Peter talks about, you're covered by the blood of the Lamb. So our problem is we think that we're hot stuff. One of my guys I know here in town, he's got a t-shirt that says, I'm actually big stuff. I'm thinking, whoa, I'm going to move aside from him. I've seen others say I'm actually hot stuff. And I'm like, okay, not, yeah, gosh, okay. Because, you know, we think, you know, God's leading us to go do something. We're going to, you know, when he led us to Boise, hey, it's going to be glorious. We got wiped out. We almost filed bankruptcy. It was horrible. It was the worst experience in our lives. God, are you really leading us? We took these bold steps of faith years ago to move to Boise, and the rug got pulled out from under us. What happened? All we wound up doing was little tiny baby steps. Did we not hear you, Lord? What happened? What we didn't understand is that he was so grateful and thankful that we could take baby steps. That's all he thought. He knew us. He was so happy. Like you when you're helping your little kid learn how to walk. If he stumbles and falls, you don't yell at him and say, well, you're not an Updike, get out of here. We'll walk. No, God doesn't do that. He'll never do that. So be encouraged, be transformed. As you take on this robe of righteousness, he knows you better than you know yourself, praise God. And he loves you. He's accepted you in the beloved. There are times when there'll be malfunctions in your breastplate of armor, kind of like when Peter so boldly was, and they just said, who am I? Well, you're the Christ, the Messiah. Jesus said, oh, praise God. My Father has revealed that to you. You're Peter, but on your bold declaration, I'm going to build my church. And then just a few verses later, when Jesus was explaining what his mission was, and Peter says, oh, no, Lord, you can't go to the cross. Far be that from you. Peter just lost his armor. And Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. Wow. Get behind me, Satan. You know, don't be around me. So don't have any malfunctions. That's a great power tool of God. To stay in him, in sync with him. And then the third one that I wanted to look at in this first section about basic training, because these are things that are just common to you. You have to do them. You have to put on that belt. You have to put on that breastplate. You know, in other words, it's always there, but you have to engage. And then he says, you're having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So this attack from Satan is kind of a weird one, because all of a sudden he'll be putting doubt and uncertainty into your life. Telling you, you know, here you're thinking, well, I've done everything right. I'm following after the Lord. I'm in the truth of his word and understand it. And I'm in the place where I'm experiencing the conviction of the Holy Spirit. But you find yourself slipping and falling. And that's because the ground you're standing on is slippery and treacherous. And you need special shoes. And notice these special shoes that, you know, Paul, as he's looking at these Roman soldiers with their nail-studded boots, they're very, very, very comfortable. They spend an enormous amount of money outfitting their soldiers with the best footwear in the empire, because they had to go miles with heavy packs. And that footwear was designed to make them stand in the battle. And notice he says what you're standing on here, it's the preparation of the gospel of peace. The word literally means the establishment of the gospel of peace. So there's two aspects of it. First of all, you really need to know the gospel in and out. Oh, no, okay, we know the gospel. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Okay, that's the gospel in a nutshell. But to really know it in and out, there's two sections I want to refer to you. I'm just going to refer them to you because I need to kind of scamper along here. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 6, and Ephesians 2, 1 through 9 detail the gospel. The good news. Literally, you are the one who is bringing good news to the people of God, about God. Good news there, it's interesting. We translated gospel because when they were translating it from the Aramaic into English, good news is gospel. But you know what the good news back in the Middle Ages was? Sellers of soap. The Middle Ages were stinky ages. So they had these itinerant travelers who would sell soap. So the word would go ahead. Here comes the ones who are bringing the gospel, the sellers of soap, that which would cleanse you, make you sweet-smelling. And Jesus is the one who will do that for you and I. He'll cleanse us of our sins. So when people see you, now, I've only had one experience where I've ever had somebody like who was demonic come. What time was I supposed to go to, James? Oh. Okay. All right. Okay, so, okay, yeah, I'll tell you. So we do this on Sunday mornings. Okay, so, yeah, there's Tom. Okay, where, no. So I was an assistant at Calvary, Boise, and we had to meet people, and here comes this guy, a bad dude. Filled up my office, little tiny office. He's a big motorcycle dude, bare-chested, black leather vest, black chaps. Fu Manchu, dark glasses, and when he took his dark glasses off, his eyes were black. There's no white in them. Worst tattoos I've ever seen in my entire life. Horrible, horrible. Turned out he was the vice president of a motorcycle gang from California. And he was a satanic high priest, done some horrible things, as he shared. The appointment after me canceled, so that was good because I had him for 2 hours. But he was scared. I could see it in his eyes. He'd done something bad, and they're going to kill him. So Boise was as far as he got, and he was out of money. And he wanted to know what we could do to help him. It's like, okay. Wow, okay. So, I obviously the gospel. But this guy, as we're talking, and he's telling me all the horrible things he's done, he's killed people. And whenever people tell me that, I always say, well, but you haven't killed Christians. Right? Because, you know, Paul involved in, you know, if Paul got saved, then you can get saved. Well, he looked at me square in the eye, and he said, I've killed Christians. And I went, gulp. My office got a little tinier. So I was sharing with him the gospel. And we got to Revelation. For some reason, we were in Revelation. And he says, we know that book. I said, you know Revelation? Yeah, we study it. Because when chaos comes, we want to reign. I looked at him. You've read Revelation? He goes, yeah. You read it to the end? Yeah. You know who wins? Yeah. So why are you on the losing side? And the scales fell off his eyes. And I turned to him to Romans. Well, I said, let me show you something about what saved this other person who'd killed Christians. I said, because if you confess with your mouth, you know, maybe that applies to some of you here today who aren't believers. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Lord, and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with heart one believes to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. For the scripture says that whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And I want to say, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace. You're being shod with the gospel of peace. Who bring glad tidings of good things. And he said, but you don't understand the oaths, the blood oaths I've taken. And I said, you don't understand our God. And the blood of his son, and he can set you free. And he experienced the salvation of his life. He actually stood up, raised his arms up, and he said, praise God, at the top of his lungs. And I'm like, wow, I've never had anybody do that before. He was set free. Mike the Destroyer. So, okay, so that was the basics, going to kind of scamper through the rest, because now we're going to move into the special ops. Because if you notice in your English there, you're going to be taking these. I know, Tom, I'm sorry. Where have I been? Huh? Excuse me. Okay, we're going to take the shield of faith. Faith is this absolute confidence in God, the promise of his power and his program for our lives. This faith refers to our present faith in the Lord Jesus for victory over sin and the host of demonic forces. I wrote that down from one of the commentators, because it's the shield of faith. And this is what, when you step up in battle, and that's why I'm calling this special ops. The others you can get by in your faith with the first three aspects of the armor, but these next three, and along with prayer, you're going to need to really enter into new territory, especially if you're struggling with an addiction, if you're moving into a new area of evangelism. These are the armor that you really need to take on into your life. The first one is the shield of faith. It was a special shield that the Roman soldiers used. It was made out of wood and iron, and it was layered with linen. And during battle, they would wet it because the enemy would shoot these fiery arrows at them. And if they didn't do that, that pitch that was on the end of the arrows would spread, and it would cause everybody to panic as they're caught on fire. But if you locked your shields together, you could defend yourselves. And he says, that's our shield of faith. That's what we're going to quench the fiery darts of the enemy. Those fiery darts, those crazy ideas that Pastor Troy had alluded to earlier, just things that he slips into your mind left and right. He's not omniscient. He doesn't know what you think. And he's not omnipresent. He's not everywhere at the same time. And he's not omnipotent. He's not all-powerful. Only God is. But he can see, because he's been studying mankind for like thousands of years, he can see what trips you up, and he'll try to trip you up. So your defense there is this shield of faith as you stand with God against the enemy. And for all of us, I think, as we're trying to struggle through with the battle that we found, one of the most powerful tools that I've experienced is memorizing the promises of God, so that as I'm in the battle, that'll hold me and protect me. When a weird thought comes in, I can cast it aside in the name of Christ, and I can move forward. The key there is to quench that dart immediately, and I want to turn to him for encouragement and for support, because he has me, and he will never leave me. He'll never forsake me. The other aspect of it is this helmet of salvation. These are the two defensive tools. And the helmet of salvation, because there's two aspects of it. The protecting of your head, obviously it's salvation. You're saved from your sins. You're protected. You've been washed by the blood of the Lamb. But also, as Paul experienced later in his life, it's going to be a protection from, and the encouragement and the hope that later on in life that you will find eternal security in Christ. So there's three aspects to our salvation. The day you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, you're justified. You're set free from your sins. It's just as if you've never sinned. And then this current state in life, from now until the day you go home to the Lord, you're being sanctified. You're being washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. And in this battle, obviously, as God allows the enemy to come into your life like he did Job, it's for your sanctification, to cleanse you and prepare you for the work of God. And the last one is glorification, that we read about in the book of Revelation, as you stand with him for all eternity. So this helmet is to encourage you. And I have friends who believe in conditional salvation. And I'm saying, I'm glad I don't, because I believe in unconditional salvation as I read my Bible. Because obviously I'm not going to take that helmet off in battle. I'm going to keep it on, and I'm going to move forward in Christ. There's two other things that he, and we're going to skip much of the stuff, but that's okay. Because I think the questions that we have set up for you, both Pastor, well, I think all three of us have set up, and then there were some others that also, I think, pitched in. They're going to amplify the armor of God. But there's two offensive weapons that I want to just touch on in this special ops as we're following Christ in this battle. One is the Word of God. As we take on, he says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And I, you know, you can, it's an interesting word that's used there for the Word of God, because it's not the it is not the logos word that we read about as Jesus is the logos there in John chapter 1, or literally the ultimate expression of God, like an arsenal, if you want to think of it, of weapons. It is the rhema, the very specific spoken word. The Greek that's used here for the sword is not the regular battle sword. It was the little, kind of like a dagger that they had. In other words, in this battle that you're going to be confronting the enemy, you want to be staying in the Word of God, where you will get receive specific scripture from the Holy Spirit, things that you've already put in your heart, things that will enable you to stand in the battle and take down the opponent. The opponent is never a physical opponent, even though Mike the Destroyer was a pretty good representation of the enemy. That's not the war that we fight. It's a spiritual war. And as the enemy attacks your thoughts, when I was in Nevada as a single guy for many years, just over the hill from my parents' house was a legal brothel, Bobby's Buckeye. And I can't tell, some of you who've driven through Tonopah, Nevada might know about Bobby's Buckeye. It was just right over the hill from my parents' house, so it was like a battle. It's like, wow. So I had to memorize scripture. The goodness of God calls me to say no to unrighteousness all the time, because it's like, you know, there it's, you know, no big deal. If you're gambling, they'll give you free drinks, and it's just a horrible place. And I was a single Christian. It was like, okay. We used to have a joke in Tonopah that there's a single woman behind every tree. And I used to say, God, how are you going to do this? Because, you know, I obviously do not have the gift of celibacy, waiting for that wife. And he imported her from Calvary, Costa Mesa. We met at a singles retreat. Up in, and we were showing our son while we were down there last week for spring break. So God can do all things, and we can trust him that he has just the right person, just the right plan for our lives. But Hebrews 4:12 says, the word of God is living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing as far as a division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. You know, it's cellular in terms of the distinction between the marrow and the bone. And he says that's how sharp the word of God can cut. One of my neighbors has an obsidian knife. I don't know if you've ever seen an obsidian knife. It actually can actually cut finer than the most precise surgical instruments, because it actually will cut through the cellular level. So it's like the word of God is even greater than that. And you can trust that God will give you just the right word at just the right time to battle the enemy. The other aspect also is prayer, and which we're going to be doing here shortly. But he says five things about prayer. Pray always. Well, how do you pray always? You going to walk around praying? No. I like the way Wiersbe was saying it. It's kind of like when you take a call in the morning and you don't hang up the call. You keep that person online for the rest of the day. That's, you start your day out with the Lord, and you stay with him throughout the day. Or I like it better, he stays with you throughout the day. As your life is an open book, as you can trust him, he says, not only praying always, but pray with all prayer and supplication. You want to pray, there's a whole bunch of prayers. And I love Philippians 4:16, as Paul was encouraging him in the faith. He says, you know, don't be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer, supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And when that happens, he says, the peace of God will fortress your mind and your heart in Christ Jesus. And that prayer, all kinds of prayers that we want to be lifting up to the Lord. I love the concept of what is prayer. Prayer is, it comes from an Old Testament word, worship. We had an awesome worship time in the Lord. But, you know, worship is literally, the word means to present yourself to God. That's all prayer is. You present yourself to God. Here I am, God. Speak to me, and I will speak to you as I bring my needs, my requests to you. Notice he says you're going to be praying in the Spirit. What's the difference between praying in the Spirit and praying in the flesh? Is the me, myself, and I. To be praying in the Spirit, to be empowered by the Holy Spirit, to be filled with the Spirit, is one who is living Simon's prayer, and I won't go to that, but Simon's prayer there in Luke is probably one of the most powerful examples of praying. You're not just checking off boxes. You're actually praying life and future into the examples that God has brought you into. And then he says, being watchful to this end. I like that, because pray with your eyes wide open. Watch and pray. Jesus was telling us all the way to watch and pray. And his disciples, unfortunately, kept falling asleep. Watch and pray. Right now, more than ever in our history, we need men of God, warriors of God, to be watching and praying. We don't know what the future holds, as Skip Hall once told us years ago, the ex-BSU football coach, but we know who holds our future. So we, as men of God, need to keep trusting him and falling after him. And then he says, with all perseverance and supplication, keep praying. Basically, what that word means, stick to it. Don't quit. We have the acronym PUSH. Pray until something happens. You get what you've been praying for, or God says no. If you don't keep praying, a great example of that is Zechariah, John the Baptist's father, in Luke chapter 1. When the angel appears to him to announce that he's going to have a son, he says, your prayers have been heard. Later we read that his wife Elizabeth had passed the age of childbirth by 30 years. For 30 years they hadn't prayed for children. That's pretty shocking. But prior to that, you know, they prayed every day, multiple times every day. And over in Revelation 5, you see God with these big pots of gold, it says, these big vials of gold that are the prayers of the saints. God treasures your prayers. God will never forget your prayers. Your prayers are always before him. He will move in them according to his perfect will and his perfect timing. In his case, it was 30 years after he'd quit praying. Wow. How can that be? It can be truth with God. And then he finishes, he says, pray for all the saints. You know, the Lord's Prayer is our Father. It's all about us, our Father. We're all this in it together. This camaraderie that we have in Christ is the one that we seek to follow him and trust him. But it starts with our Father. So my apologies for running over, but I did want one more thing to get. Because if you're kind of like me and you lose lists and you forget when you're supposed to be finished, there is hope for us. Because when you're in the battle and you're trying to remember, okay, now which let's see, do I need? Oh, no, that was, do I need the breastplate or do I need the shoes? You know what's really cool is Jesus. In Isaiah 59:20, he is described as a redeemer. And it's talked about him putting on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head. But you know, every one of the armor of God that we talked about this afternoon, Jesus fulfilled. And he is a picture of the whole armor of God. He is the truth in John 14:6. He is our righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He is our peace. Ephesians 2:14. He is our shield of faith. Hebrews 12:2. He is the captain of our salvation. Hebrews 2:10. And he is the word of God made flesh. John 1:1 and John 14. You know, what's kind of interesting is Paul, when he's talking to them, to the Christians in Rome, in Romans 13:11, he tells the Christians in Rome, who obviously are under the domain of the Roman Empire, what they're supposed to do with this armor that God has given them. First of all, in verse 11 of Romans 13, he says, you have to wake up. Wake up. Then he says in verse 12, you have to cast off sin and you put on the armor of light. And then in verse 13, he says, in verse 14, we do this by putting on the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you're struggling with, okay, I'm in the middle of the battle, what do I do? I've got Mike the Destroyer staring down at me. He looks like he's going to eat me. Put on Jesus Christ. Put on Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, he says, God will never tempt you by more than what you can bear as long as you take the way of escape. What's the way of escape? Jesus Christ. So if you're challenged in any of those areas, struggling in those areas, you can always remember, put on Jesus Christ. And he'll fill you and encourage you. He'll bless you. And you'll be a participant of what he describes as the abundant life. Amen?
All right. You guys are so much fun that I had to come back for more. So, did you guys like that breakout time?
Yeah.
Good feedback? All right. Glad to hear it. So we put these questions together from the guys that taught to ask them what they were hoping your application was from what they taught on. So this is kind of where the rubber meets the road. What are you hoping to get? So what I need from you guys is basically a spokesman from one of the two or three of you guys that met together on who wants to fill this in. And one at a time. So the first one is, do you believe that there is a spiritual warfare happening today? Why or why not? Is this a hard one to answer?
No.
No? Anybody struggle? Yeah?
Lies and evil is good.
Now, what was the first part?
Lies.
Lies? Yeah. Lies everywhere. Wow. Awesome. Awesome. So the solution out of that is... Stop watching the news. It's all fake anyway. It's all a ruse. So, you know, my group hit something a little bit here, that sometimes there's something stronger that we need, right? There's this surface level that we see things at, and then there's this level down here that we need with authenticity before God. And it just hit us when we were reading this. It was like, wow. That's pretty heavy. It's actually kind of a word that God has hit me with ever since I've, you know, for 32 years I've lived in Idaho. It's just something God spoke to me when I first moved here. He wanted back that authentic heart relationship with me, and thank goodness I responded at some point. It was actually at a men's retreat. It was with a bunch of guys like you. Imagine that. Second one says, do you take seriously the fact that you have a new nature and an old nature?
Yes.
You did? What did you come up with in terms of how is it manifested in a new nature and an old nature? What does it look like? Any of you guys right here?
We pointed this one.
Because you said yes, yes, yes. What's that? Yeah? Do you struggle with this? Old nature, new nature? Yeah? When's it over?
I think it's ever over. I think when I get to heaven.
I was here for Troy's talk. I'm just trying to listen. It's not an argument. In what ways does spiritual warfare urge you to respond to it? And what kinds of things are you doing to address the problem of having two natures? This is really way too applicational for us, isn't it?
Combat the old nature, but apply everything to Jesus
Christ. Yeah, what sustains your new nature?
Stay in the Word.
Stay in the Word, right? What else sustains your new nature? Yeah, never forget where you came from, right? Don't forget where you came from, man. God's, my old life, I came to the Lord, I was miserable as a non-believer. God just made me so miserable, I just couldn't stand it anymore. And I just came to him, I'm like, this is way better. That was my experience.
I got a little different view of that, because Jackson was talking to us, and he's been raised with the Lord, you know?
Yeah.
So he doesn't have the stories as most
right
people
on.
Do. So it was a little different take that Jackson gave us, and it's like, you know, he's like, without having the views from everybody, that kind of sustains him from doing these things. So
yeah.
Different.
Yeah, keep it in view how bad things can be, huh, Jackson? Do you have anything to add to that?
No, I think that's it.
That's it? Yeah, just be aware of how bad it can be. You know, if you serve and you help folks that are struggling in these areas, you see, man, their lives are destroyed.
But they still don't want to listen.
No. Some people are stubborn. Not me, just you guys. Yeah, and this one was really just inclined to get you and your groups to make sure that you've covered your testimony. We don't want anybody to leave here without an opportunity to know Jesus personally and to have that relationship, to be initiating a spiritual life in the Lord. I spoke about it, Ernest talked about it, Troy even alluded to it. So important. And that's all this was about your new nature. Realize it's a new nature by birth, so it's not something that is Satan can take away from you. Right? Always, always, wherever you're at, God's ready to accept you back in to grow and to mature from where you're at. We're talking about this today with some of us. We just recognize where your position was, whether you were saved initially and then you backslid and did this, and all of those stories are kind of irrelevant in the point that God is always ready to take you back and improve and help you do better. Because the story's not over till it's over. Right? So that's important, really important to get. It's what you end up with, not how you get there. What can you commit to improve your spiritual awareness to the subtle schemes of the enemy? Did you guys come up with anything?
Be actively involved in someone else's life.
Oh, nice. Actively involved. That's kind of where we're getting at. How does that help you, though? What does that prevent when you do that?
Isolation. We were seeing that you can see somebody else's struggles.
Yeah.
And you can relate that to yourself.
So you see other struggles and you relate that to yourself? Yeah. And the main point here is like we talked about, if you leave a piece of armor off, guess where the enemy's going to attack you? Right where that part is. Right? Or if you're in a position where, I mean, we all live in a world where we have certain strengths and weaknesses, even spiritually speaking, and we have blind spots, don't we? And without fellowship, we're not addressing those blind spots. And we have to address those. And that takes the dirty word, vulnerability with one another. So it's awesome. You guys have done a great job with that part of it. Question 6 says, we are all in this together. What can you do to help your fellow brothers and sisters strengthen their spiritual stance or battle plan? Obviously, we're in this together. We're all up here committed to this. But what can you do to help your fellow brothers and sisters to strengthen their battle plan?
Pledge accountability to each other.
Nice. Wow. Did I plant you? Did I give you the answer? Did I tell you that on Thursday? Monday? Mike here. That's funny. It's funny that he would speak up right then, because one of the keys, I really think, I do a men's group on Thursday morning at 10:30. Mike's part of it, and he knows how important that is to fellowship with one another, and that's really important. And the unfortunate thing is, in the past, we haven't been able to offer more of this, and we're kind of waiting on the Lord. And the Lord has provided a brother who he actually couldn't make it this weekend. He's a good brother. A lot of you guys know him in Meridian, George Leha. So George is going to be starting a men's group starting next H2H session in April, and that'll be at 6:30 in the morning. That takes away a lot of you all's excuses not to fellowship with other men. Doesn't it? So I love this. The early morning time frame has been the most successful time frame in bigger Calvaries. And Chuck, you might know, do you guys have early morning men's groups? Were they heavily attended?
Yes and no. I mean, you know, some groups were. There were some breakfasts and there were some just prayer times. And
yeah.
There were quite a few groups. Yeah.
Yeah. A little more so than the evening, do you think?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. That's my experience. It's a little better than the evening. Yep. It's something you can do as a man separately from your family to go strengthen yourself and then go be the leader and servant that God's called you to be in your family. It's wonderful that way. George is an awesome, mature brother. He has been through the ringer in his life. You'll get to know that story a little bit as you go through the book of Acts with him. So there's my commercial for him.
When's that?
It'll be at the Annex. It'll be 6:30 on Tuesday mornings. And James?
Yeah.
Did we confirm?
Brian?
6:30. Brian?
We're working on it still.
We're working on an evening one.
Yeah.
So we'll cover you on all three. If you're retired, you can come to mine or Chuck's in the middle of the morning, or you can go early in the morning to George's that he'll be doing on Tuesdays. And then I think we're going to...
Mine will be at like 7
at night. 7 in the evening, probably. You're thinking Tuesday evening?
We're trying.
We're working on it. We're working on that one. So look for that in H2H, you guys. This really is important. It answers about every question on here to do this, doesn't it? It helps, at least. So what can you do to maintain an awareness of the battleground for the truth? So
Satan is the father of lies. Jesus is the father of truth. Amen.
Amen. That awesome. Satan is the author of lies. So we need some spiritual discernment there, doing what we're doing right now, doing more of this, doing this in men's groups. Again, it just answers the same problem. Number 8 says, what lies from the devil have you been believing?
People are generally
good. You're still trying to get over that one?
You don't believe that?
No, that's one of the lies. That people are generally good. That at heart, people are mostly good. And it turns out, we're all sinners. The good people have submitted their lives to Christ.
The Bible says there's none good, not one.
None good, not one. Excellent. Thank you for that reference.
Technology.
That's awesome. Did you think it's going to... save the world, or it's going to, and it winds up eating up so much of your time that you can't even function in other ways and make a human connection and help somebody get saved one-on-one. Instead, you're worrying about what all the enemies are saying on media or social media or something like that, right?
Yes.
Yep. And so, excellent. God, this stuff's good. Who wrote these questions? This was Ernest. Number 9, which piece of spiritual armor are you most confident in and why? And which piece are you least confident in? So, how many of you guys were most confident in the helmet of salvation? Raise your hand. All right. Okay, how many of you guys were most confident in your shield of faith? Well, that's a pretty good number, too. How many of you guys were most confident in your boots? In the footing. Nobody's got. James, you got good footing,
always
brother?
Taking ground for Christ, brother. Always taking ground for Christ.
You got cleats on the bottom of your shoes, huh? Good job, brother. Yeah.
Are we allowed to go back to number 8 real quick?
Okay.
I think we skip it as men. I just got a divorce, and I think I was really performance oriented. And had those fears of rejection, just those self-conscious fears. And I think all as men, we got fears in this. So I think the devil will use those old lies. Like, I want people to impress me. Look how much money, how many trucks, how many businesses, how busy I am, how much I do stuff in church. I'm teaching Sunday school.
Yeah.
And that's the biggest lie, because we all have a little narcissistic ego stuff in us being guys.
Yeah.
We need this ridicule. It'll ruin your life.
Ruin your life.
I can tell you myself, I've lost this one.
Yeah.
That's what I want, because you'll all cry.
I'll be praying for Greg. Oh, Greg, we're so sorry. You know that on that vein, we wound up with a word on here, a section that just talked about these lies that produce guilt and shame.
Yeah.
And it really gets at the core of what you're saying. There's probably no more destructive force in human nature than guilt in our culture. Guilt will destroy it. And how much are we relieved spiritually when we just turn it all over to Jesus and he forgives us for our sins? It gives us confidence in that forgiveness. It, put on the helmet of salvation. So awesome. I love
that. Ask your wife. Just go, what's going on with me? Why am I so weird?
Yeah.
Why am I causing you problems? Let's fix it. Go see somebody. Gosh.
You ask your wife, she'll tell you.
Yeah.
Too much if you don't say nothing.
If you guys can't identify your weakness,
ask your wife.
Amen. And then follow through with what she said.
I'm afraid. It'll start a fight for me. But. All right. Good. Great point. Thanks for reiterating that, Greg. Appreciate it. What can we do right now together to be victorious in this spiritual war that we face? And then what can we do in the future to maintain it? Do you guys have any?
Can you repeat that again?
What can we do right now together to be victorious in the spiritual war that we face?
Not let your friendships grow cold.
Yeah.
Nice. Man, can you come up here? No. Thank you. That's awesome.
Develop a chain of people to call
like a prayer chain? Yeah.
Need prayer. People you know you can talk to.
Very cool.
Things that you're
If you don't have anything else, develop people you can call. Say, I'm going through it. Yeah. It's okay. It's pick one guy.
Yeah.
Say, will you be that guy for me? The guy you just met with just a few minutes ago, maybe. Just an idea.
Be bold with each other.
Yeah. Don't be afraid to ask. Are you doing okay? Seriously.
Right. Yeah. You have a problem with alcohol? How are you doing with alcohol?
Yeah. Yeah, you know that a brother has a problem. He's addicted to porn on the internet. You know that's something for him. And he says, no, I got victory. This is where I'm at. It's been months and months. It's doing great. You meet with him again out of the blue. What do you need to ask him? Are you doing okay there?
How's that going?
How's that battle? Are you winning that? Are you hanging tough? And he tells you, no, it's just been a couple weeks. And you're like, whoa, what happened? You need to help each other. This accountability fellowship is so important. So I just encourage you towards that. Maintaining it is just like Alan just said. Don't let your friendships grow cold. That's awesome. One of the ways that we do in Calvary Boise, I don't know if you have it here, Ernest, in Garden Valley, but just having H-to-H small group meetings and having a close-knit fellowship where at least if you're you know, falling and biffing your nose, spiritually speaking, you've got some folks to help lift you up and take care of you. So sometimes we just go off on our own and we go die in the woods, and that's really what we don't want to do. We don't want to become isolated and go die in the woods. That's not the objective here. We want to stay connected.
That's the one the lion devours. It's the one isolated.
Yep. Yeah, just look at the natural realm and what happens there in the natural realm, right? The isolated animal needs to get back in the pack or he's going to get wiped out, right? He's the one that the lion is going to eat. And I don't know if you've ever seen that. That's painful to watch. Yeah, it's on National Geographic. You can watch it all day. All right. Yes, sir.
Being the relative new person and an outsider that came from outside of Calvary Chapel any place.
Oh, yeah.
And having been, I was involved in a job where I was in two different states, and we were living in two different states, one week here, we had houses in each place. So we went to two different churches.
Yeah.
Prior to that, we went to another church. None of them were Calvary Chapel.
Yeah.
I've never seen a church like Meridian that's so on fire. We go to three different activities. We go to a house to house. I go to the Wednesday truck Bible study.
Yeah.
Marathon and the Thursday. And it is like we were talking on the way up here. We've got how many? 20 house to house?
Yeah. 20 some, I think. Is Brian still here?
But that's 200
no,
people
no.
with little,
he would know.
Little churches.
Yeah.
Nobody's going to stop that up.
Yeah.
It's there. We're going to meet no matter what anybody tells us.
Yeah.
It's got a lot to be proud of. This church is really on fire.
Well, there's, and that subject, neither this church here nor our church down there are in the mega big church category, and there's a real advantage to the smaller sizes that we are. There's a connection point that we have and accountability. There's a real advantage to that. The downside of that is, just like here and just like in Meridian, you keep doing it well and it won't stay small forever. But the important thing is that the quality of what is being brought across stays high. And that's our prayer, our goal. It's not to do it artificially or any other way. It just...
There's nothing artificial about
this. I don't detect.
I'm part of it now, but there's nothing artificial about this. This is good.
Yeah. Well, awesome. Praise the Lord. Yeah, praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand. On that vein, we're going to do communion here, if you guys don't mind. I feel like God wants us to kind of connect up before we get going. So communion helpers, can you grab the communion elements and pass them out? So I just want to admonish you guys as the elements are coming out. Jesus, on the very last Passover celebration before he broke the mold on it, so to speak, came together with his disciples, and there was a form of unity that occurred with them, a goodbye, if you will. And for us, this is kind of the end of what we're doing, so this is kind of a goodbye also. But he wanted to send with them something to commemorate what he had accomplished, and this... You start to think this—that's what the Lord's Supper really does for it. It commemorates His work on the cross. So, oh, we're going as fast as we can.
Hey, can we? You want to sing a song while we're passing it out?
Yeah, it's probably gonna take a few minutes.
Yeah.
We got worship.
We got worship first, so we got worship.
We got worship.
Tom, are you gonna leave?
You want me to? You want me to leave it on? I'll step out of the way.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name.
I'll sing that again, my hope.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, you His Lord, Lord of all.
When darkness seems hide His face,
when darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. It in every high and stormy gale. My anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, when He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, Christ alone. Cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He
too late. So as I was saying, that communion, the Lord's Supper, was right before Jesus went to the cross. And there's a verse in 1 Corinthians that's kind of the typical one that we use. And it says in verse 23, chapter 11, verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it, and He said, 'Take and eat. This is My body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me.'" So if you guys will, in honor of our Lord Jesus, His broken body, go ahead and take the bread. Lord, we're so grateful that, Lord, You paid Your sacrifice on the cross. And then You proved it all when You came through the other side and rose from the dead. God, that reality in Your resurrection, Lord, lives in our hearts today. We commemorate it with the celebration of Your blood symbolically poured out in this covenant of the new commandment. He said in verse 25, "In the same manner He also took the cup after supper, and He said, 'This cup is the new covenant in My blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me.'" If you drink the cup. So here's the cool promise out of this. He finishes with, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." What does He mean when He comes? He's coming back. It's good news. Based on a lot of evidence these days, It's not that far away. The church has lived with the doctrine of imminency and the imminent return of Jesus Christ for a long time. There's no doubt. Apostle Paul talked about it like it was going to happen in his day. But we look at what we see today. Man, does it seem close to me. Closer than ever. You just wonder how many more prophecies could be fulfilled before we have to be out of here. So, we'll see.
Leave a couple of those and it might be over.
Yeah, a few of those might just institute the Antichrist right in the power. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this commemoration of your precious, precious gift to us, new birth, God. May we remember always, God, that the Spirit that rose you from the dead, Jesus, lives in each one of us, God. May we celebrate that in one another. May we give it to one another. May we sharpen each other in that. May we love on each other and invest our lives in one another. God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for the authentic work of your Holy Spirit in each one of us, God, to be drawn towards you. And gosh, we're drawn to you as well. What a beautiful connection point you have. We appreciate your grace and your love in our life. And we pray that you continue to just fill us up to overflowing. Just pour your Spirit out upon us, God, as we go, as we live for you, as we attempt to just improve our position, spiritually speaking, God. We know that you'll honor that, God, and we just ask you to do that in our hearts, our lives, and we pray that you'll just carry it forward in the lives of the churches that are represented here in this fellowship. We just thank you for it all, and may you just bless the rest of this time of worship before we go, and we thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Before we all drive back down the hill. Unless you live up here, then you're not driving back down the hill. There is that caveat, of course, right? My life is built on your faithfulness. My hope is held in your promises. I take each step with your confidence, 'cause I am yours. I am yours. You never fail, you never will. I'll trust your name for greater things. You will come through, you always do. I'll trust your name for greater things. You cleared a way in the wilderness. You brought me back from brokenness. You took my shame and you buried it. What you've done, I won't forget. You never fail, you never will. I'll trust your name for greater things. You will come through, you always do. I'll trust your name for greater things. You are with me. I'll see this fight from the victory. No power of hell stand against me. I've seen this fight from the victory. I will not fear. I will not fear. You are with me. I'll see this fight from the victory. No power of hell stand against me. I've seen this fight from the victory. You never fail. You never will. I'll trust your name for greater things. You will come through. You always do. I'll trust your name for greater things.
Heavenly Father, we do just thank you for this time, Lord. We thank you again for this opportunity. And for these men of God bringing your word, Lord, through your spirit, for everything that was done here, that it would glorify you, Lord, that you would bring it to our remembrance, Lord, and that it would be just a monument in us, Lord, that you would bring back to us when needed. Your spirit would remind us of these conversations, of these teachings, Lord, that you are with us. It is your strength. It is your power, Lord, your truth, your word, Lord, your salvation. It is nothing of us. That's the main point. It is not in us, but it's you, Lord. So let us put away the old man. And let us embrace the greatness that you have for us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.